I'm William Zinsser, and on this tape I'm going to tell you some things that I know will help you to write. Things I've learned in my own work as a writer, and as an editor, and as a teacher of writing, and that are in my book On Writing Well, which is an informal guide to writing nonfiction, writing about the world we live in. This tape has nothing to do with fiction, with novels or short stories or poems or plays. My book has helped a tremendous number of people of all ages and in all kinds of work to write well and with confidence and with enjoyment. And I know I can also help you. Almost all of us have to do a certain amount of writing just to get through the day, more than we realize. And almost all of us approach the task with a certain amount of fear, or quite a lot of fear, or at least a certain amount of anxiety. Fear of writing is planted in most people at an early age, often by the English teacher who tells us we don't have a gift for words. So a lot of people go through life paralyzed from doing useful work or from doing even the simplest kinds of writing just because they never learned how to express themselves in writing comfortably. But writing is not a special language that's owned by the English teacher, a gift that some people are born with and others are not. Writing is thinking on paper. Anybody who thinks clearly should be able to write clearly. Writing is a craft, not an art. Often it's raised to an art, but 99% of the time it's a craft, and an honorable one, like carpentry, like plumbing, with its own set of tools, which are words. And like all tools, they'll do the job if they're used right. There's no subject that can't be made accessible to an ordinary reader by writing good English. Many people think they can't write about their field without using its jargon or its technical vocabulary. But if you learn to use the language simply and warmly, and you can, you'll be able to make any subject clear. However complicated you may think it is, it can be reduced to good English just by putting one sentence after another. I don't mean that it's easy. It's not. Writing is hard. Nobody in America seems to realize this. Professional writers are always being approached by people who say they'd like to try a little writing sometime, meaning when they retire from the hard thing they're doing now, like banking or insurance. Or they say, I could write a book about that. I doubt it. It may seem unkind to tell you that writing is hard. I think it should be a consolation. I'm always amazed by how many people assume that professional writers just sit down to write and whatever they want to write comes right out. On the contrary, the longer most writers write, the more they rewrite, the more they fiddle, trying to finally say exactly what they want to say with as much freshness as possible. So if you find writing hard, it's because it is hard. It's one of the hardest things people do because it requires logical thinking. And we all know how hard that is. Writing's hard for everybody. Very few sentences come out right the first time, or the second time. A clear sentence is no accident. On the other hand, getting that sentence right on the third try or the fourth try is a great satisfaction. When you get all your sentences together, one after another, saying something clearly that you want to say in a voice that sounds like you, that's an achievement you can be very proud of and one that I think you can learn very quickly. Remember, writing is not a contest. All writers are starting from a different point and are going to a different destination. They're also going at different speeds. So whatever you're trying to write, don't worry about what anybody else is writing. Writing is a transaction between two people, you, the writer, and the person who's reading what you've written. Writing is talking to somebody else on paper. So your only real contest is with yourself to master this craft. I have four basic principles of good writing. I'll tell you what they are, and then I'll come back to them. My four principles are clarity, simplicity, brevity, and humanity. If you keep those four principles in mind, there's almost nothing you can't do. First, clarity. If it isn't clear, you might as well not write it. You might as well stay in bed. Clarity is the goal in writing, the main prize. It's also surprisingly hard to achieve, because most sentences as they're first written have a tendency, almost like a law of physics, to come out just a little bit wrong. I got a notice the other day from my cable TV service, and it said, next month we will upgrade our phones, so it will be difficult to reach us. I heard about a memo the other day from an office supervisor. He said he wanted a list of all employees broken down by sex. Well, those are typical of the countless sentences we read every day that don't come out quite the way the writer meant them to. They're not clear. And if you can't make your writing clear to other people, there's no reason why other people should struggle to read it. They shouldn't waste their time and their energy. Life is too short. Principle number two, simplicity. The crippling disease in American writing is clutter. It's the main enemy. We're a society strangling in unnecessary words and meaningless jargon and pompous frills. There's so much verbal bloatage in the air that you can hardly hear a plain declarative sentence anymore. The tendency is to inflate and thereby make ourselves sound important. The airline pilot who announces that he is presently anticipating experiencing considerable precipitation wouldn't dream of saying that it may rain. It's too simple. Therefore, there must be something wrong with it. The very word experiencing is typical of the disease. Your dentist will ask you if you are experiencing any pain. If you had his own kid in the chair, he'd say, "Does it hurt?" He's like the airline hostess who asks us to kindly extinguish all smoking materials. It's a terrifying sentence. I always wonder what materials are smoking. The point is we must strip the language back down. We must get rid of all the pretentiousness and the pomposity and the fat. You as a writer must constantly tell yourself that simplicity is a virtue in writing. It's the main virtue after clarity. It's not something to be ashamed of, something that has to be embroidered with fancy stitches. The writing we most admire over the years, the King James Bible, Shakespeare, Abraham Lincoln, one of my favorite stylists, Thoreau, E.B. White, Red Smith, is writing that has the strength of simplicity. Ironically, the higher people get in their education and their job, the more suspicious they are of simplicity, the more they want to put on airs. I took a train the other day, and the conductor said, "Kindly do not congregate in the vestibules." We don't need that. He meant don't block the aisles. People in authority, from train conductors to corporate CEOs, are prisoners of the idea that a simple style reflects a simple mind. The exact opposite is true. A simple style is the result of very hard work. As the old saying goes, hard writing makes easy reading. A muddle style is the result of someone who's too lazy or too arrogant to organize his thoughts. Or, as the old saying also goes, easy writing makes hard reading. My third principle is brevity, saying things in the most economical way, not giving the reader anything he or she doesn't need. Writing is like a good watch. It ought to function smoothly and have no extra parts to get in the way. So, short is better than long. Short words are better than long words. Don't use numerous when you can use many. Don't use assistance when you can use help. Short sentences are better than long sentences. Short paragraphs are better than long paragraphs. Short articles are better than long articles. I've found as an editor and as a teacher that most pieces of writing can be cut by 50% without losing anything organic or losing the writer's voice, and the final result is always much better. If you give me a piece of writing and I tell you to go and cut it by 50%, you'll howl and say it can't be done. Then you'll go and do it, and it'll be much better. You will have looked at your piece objectively and seen that it's full of clutter, weeds that are smothering what you write. Try it. Turn off this tape and go and cut the last thing you wrote by 50%. But wait a minute. Before you go, here are a few more things to look for. The kinds of things you can cut. Most adverbs are unnecessary. The radio blared loudly. Blare is a wonderful verb that means loud. It even has its meaning in its sound, blare, as many verbs do. Wheedle, choke, clash, slump, stifle. That's one of the wonderful things about verbs. So when you drape an adverb onto them that has the same meaning that's in the verb, you're putting clutter in the reader's path, something that shouldn't be there. You're also notifying the reader that you're not a careful writer. Most adjectives are also unnecessary. Writers throw them into their sentences just for decoration or by habit. and the sentences get longer and longer as they fill up with frisky kittens and sleepy lagoons and hard-bitten detectives and stately elms. Not every oak has to be gnarled. It's all clutter. I'm also thinking of all those phrases like in a sense or in a funny sort of way that don't mean anything. And all those little qualifiers, sort of, kind of, a bit, a little, hedging words that dilute your authority as a writer. And all those phrases in which the writer announces what he or she is about to do. It is interesting to note that, often followed by something stupefying. It should be pointed out, I might add. If it's interesting to note, make it interesting. If it should be pointed out, point it out. If you might add, add it. My rule of thumb is that every component in a piece of writing should be doing useful work, new work, work that hasn't been done up to that point. So when you go over what you've written, if you find anything in it that you can't justify, the sentence would be perfectly clear without it. Ask yourself, do I need it? Chances are you don't. So learn to cut, and to enjoy cutting. One of the biggest pleasures of writing is to see how much more alive your writing becomes when it's stripped down to its essentials and isn't choked by all these weeds, all this clutter. Brevity also applies to sentences. Short sentences are better than long sentences for a very simple reason, which is, most readers can only process one thought at a time. Writing is linear and sequential. Sentence B must logically follow sentence A, and sentence C must logically follow sentence B, or all the well-written sentences in the world will finally add up to chaos. So your job as the writer is to present one idea in a sentence and let the reader grasp that idea, and then present the next idea and let the reader grasp that, and so on. Much of the trouble that writers get into comes from trying to make a sentence do more than it can do. A sentence is a fragile mechanism. It can't hold too much. And most sentences, as we first write them, get longer and hopelessly tangled as we load them down with ideas that aren't related, that aren't comfortable with each other. So learn to break a long sentence into two short sentences, or into three short sentences. There's no sentence that's too short to be acceptable in the eyes of God. Okay, now turn off the tape and go and cut the last thing you wrote by 50%. And have a good time doing it. Finally, the fourth principle, humanity. This principle underlies all the others, and it's crucial. So please, be natural. Be yourself. Never say anything in writing that you wouldn't comfortably say in conversation. If you're not the kind of person who says, indeed, or moreover, please don't say it in writing. Most people trying to write sit down to commit an act of literature, and the person who emerges on paper is very much stiffer than the person who sat down to write. It's amazing how often an editor can find the perfect lead in an article by simply throwing away the first two or three paragraphs, or the first two or three pages, and starting the article where the writer finally stops building this elaborate edifice, the lead, the sacred lead, and begins to relax and sound like himself or herself. What I'm always looking for as an editor is a sentence that says something like, I'll never forget the day when I, and I think, aha, there's a person. Up to that point, no person has been visible because the writer has been making this self-conscious construction, the lead, full of vague generalizations that has no life of its own.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.